Praise the Lord. Praise the mighty Jesus. Please join me in singing this chorus. The rock that never fails, let me hide in thee. Let me hide in thee. In thee there's forgiveness, the rock that never fails. Let me hide in thee. Let me hide in thee. In thee there is mercy, the rock that never fails. Let me hide in thee. Let me hide in thee. In thee there is power, the rock that never fails. Let me hide in thee. Let me hide in thee. In thee there is abundance, the rock that never fails. Let me hide in thee. Let me hide in thee. In thee there is healing. We could sing that song over and over for the next 2 hours. There's so much to gain from the Lord our God. Let us pray. Unto you, O Lord God Most High, be honor, glory, adoration, dominion, and power forever and ever. We thank you, Father, for your unfailing love and mercy towards us. We pray for the forgiveness and pardon of all our sins and iniquities. Create in us new and right spirit in Jesus' name. O Lord, teach us your ways, feed us with your word, and bless us richly today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We give glory to the Most High God for his unfailing love towards us. We also thank our Father in the Lord, the Right Reverend Dr. Olusola Odedeji, and our Mama Lagos West, Mrs. Lydia Odedeji, for their spiritual guidance and influence in our lives. We are grateful to our Dean and Mama Dean, the Venerable Adegoke and Mrs. Oluwatoyin Agara, for tirelessly nurturing us with the word of God. May the Lord bless and keep them. May Jehovah Lord prosper the work of their hand and enlarge their territories in Jesus' name. We pray for all our men of God, that the power of the Holy Spirit falls afresh on them, and that the Lord backs up their words with his awesome power in Jesus' name. The topic before us today is Lessons from the Brook Cherish. Lessons from the Brook Cherish. Our text is taken from 1 Kings 16, 29 to 34. And 1 Kings 17, 1 to 16. According to the dictionary, a brook is a small stream that is usually fed by rain and dew water. A brook can therefore dry up for lack of rain or dew. In order for us to have a good understanding of the topic, we shall discuss it by answering three relevant questions. The first would be, why did Elijah go to the brook Cherith? And the second would be, what happened at the brook Cherith? Why did Elijah go to the brook Cherith? And what happened at the brook Cherith? And the third one would be, what happened when the brook Cherith dried up? The first being, why did he go to the brook? The second, what happened at the brook? And the third, what happened when the brook dried up? So I want to start with the first one. Why did Elijah go to the brook Cherith? From the first part of our text, that is the 1 Kings 16, 29 to 34, we learned that Ahab, the king of Israel, continued to provoke God to anger with his activities, some of which were, he worshipped and served Baals, erected and worshipped graven images. He did more evils in the sight of God, more than all the kings before him. He walked in the sins of Jeroboam. He married Jezebel, daughter of Ethbaal, an idol worshipper. Therefore, all his actions were very provocative to God. Prophet Elijah the Tishbite condemned the king's utter disregard for the God of Israel. He noted all these behaviors from King Ahab, and he was very angry with the king. This was why Elijah called for famine and drought on the land. Elijah declared, "As the Lord lives, before whom I stand, there shall be no dew or rain this year except at my word." 1 Kings 17, verse 1. This was no doubt a very strong declaration. I pray that you and I will be able to act on the word of the Lord and declare even his judgments in Jesus' name. Elijah's declaration was backed up by the Lord. There was neither rain nor dew on the land, so there was famine. But God sent his word to Elijah to go to the brook. So this was the reason why Elijah went to the brook. He said Elijah should go to the brook where he would be fed by ravens and he could drink from the brook. From the above, we can learn a few lessons. The first one is that we must respect and revere men of God. We need to respect and revere our men of God. We should do all we can to earn their blessings and not their condemnation, because God backs up their words with his power. We must be careful. I want to say, particularly in our communion, we tend to take our men of God for granted. They deserve reverence. That is what the Lord expects from us. Even their wives are not allowed to taunt them. Their wives are not even allowed to speak to them anyhow, because they are servants of the Most High God. We could learn from the example in 2 Samuel 6, 16 to 23, where Michal, David's wife, taunted him for dancing openly in praise of God. Bible recorded that she was the only barren that died without a child. It is that serious. We have no business judging our men of God. They should be respected. And we should try our best not to incur the wrath of God like Ahab did. Even where we believe that the man of God erred, if we cannot pray for him, let's leave him to his God. It's not in our place to castigate them. We have no business pulling them down. May the Lord help us in Jesus' name. Because we can even learn the importance of this lesson to respect our men of God from the story of Eli, the high priest, who was not in God's good books. Ordinarily, you and I would want to, that man, God is not even happy with him. But his word to Anna was backed up by God, and it became prophetic. This is written in 1 Samuel chapter 1, verses 13 to 18. So please, let us honor our men of God. The second point here is that we need to be careful about our choice of a partner in marriage. Either we need a wife or a husband. It must be chosen with the direction of the Holy Spirit. This is particularly relevant to our children, because most of us have already made our choices. A bad choice could jeopardize their destiny. Please, let us hammer it into our children that they must choose their life partner by the guidance and direction of the Holy Spirit, because bad choice could lead to destruction of destiny and even death, as we found out from Ahab, who chose an idol worshiper. The third lesson is that we must be in right standing with God. We are Christians. We believe in God, even as Elijah believed in God. I wonder if you and I can boldly say before the Lord, whom I stand. God doesn't just back anyone or anything up. It has to be anything that is in accordance with his word. When we are in right standing with God, we have the confidence that he will hear us and he will back up our words with power. That is why we can prophesy as children of God. Whatever we say, if it's in accordance with the word of God, it shall stand. So that, like Elijah, we can say, as the Lord lives, before whom I stand. The phrase, before whom I stand, implies, amongst others, before whom I worship, before whom I bow down to, before whom has the total control of my life, before whom I am answerable to, the one who controls my going out and coming in, before whom is my Alpha and Omega. Before God can back up our words, he has to be our Alpha and our Omega. He has to be our Lord, who directs all our deeds, who tells us to go and we go, come and we come, and he has to be our Savior. It is only then that our words will be backed up by him. Brethren, before whom do we stand? Before idols, graven images, adultery, cults, or money, etc., etc. We need to search our heart. Before whom and what controls us? Who and what controls us? If we stand before anything or anyone other than the living God, the Rock of Ages, then we must retrace our steps quickly, because Jesus is the only way, the truth, and the life. John 14:6. The Bible also says, there is a way that seemeth right unto man, but the end thereof are ways of death. Proverbs 14:12. So those of us who follow other people to do things at night that are not acceptable to the Lord our God, the Bible says it leads to death. Let us be careful. We can also learn from our text that the Lord cares and provides for his own. God sent a word to Elijah to depart from the land because of famine and turn eastwards. Elijah did not even ask God to provide for him. He was just so angry with the king that he called down famine, probably not even minding that he will also be dwelling in that land. But the good Lord, who sees our hearts and who cares and loves us, sent his word to Elijah to depart from the land because of the famine and turn eastwards to hide by the brook Cherish, from which he would drink, and that God had commanded ravens to feed him morning and evening with bread and meat. Awesome God, our Jehovah Jireh. He provides for all our needs. May the Lord make ways for us where there seems to be no way, in Jesus' name. The word of the prophet is the word of God. This is another lesson we should learn from here. There was drought and famine in the land because of the word of Elijah. The Bible tells us that when a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord and it comes to pass, then God had spoken. Deuteronomy 18:22. This means the absence of rain on the land confirmed that God had spoken. God speaks through his servants. let you and I listen and hear them. And may their words bring blessing and comfort to us in Jesus' name. Famine and drought could be due to sins. This is another thing that we could learn from this text. Sometimes in life, we may experience drought physically, probably through health challenges, financially, professionally, academically, or even spiritually. We should search ourselves and repent of convicted sin. Sin brings stagnation. It brings failure. It brings shame. It works against our peace and our progress. So when we find ourselves in this kind of situation, let us learn to lift our eyes unto the Lord and cry out for his salvation. As we learned from the text, famine was due to the sins of Ahab. The Bible tells us in Jeremiah 50:38 that a drought is against our water, and they are dried up because it is a land of graven image. Brethren, what kind of land is the land of Nigeria? What kind of land are we dwelling on? May the Lord deliver our land from idolatry in Jesus' name. There is no doubt that sins bring about famine. Let us avoid sin and confess our sins where we are convicted. And so, one of the things that is so important to learn from here is that it is our responsibility to pray for our leaders. And I'm not talking of religious leaders alone. I thank God for the Anglican Communion. Every time that we gather, every Sunday, we pray for the president, we pray for all our leaders, political leaders, spiritual leaders. That is how it should be. We are not to ignore these people. Because from the text, we learn that the sins that brought about famine on the land were largely committed by King Ahab and his household. Yet, the entire land was punished. So, if our leaders are committing sin, then you and I are in danger of punishment. We could also learn this in 2 Samuel chapter 24, verses 1 to 13. We saw that when David disobeyed God and counted Israel, the Bible recorded that 70,000 men were killed, but none died from David's household. Let me repeat that. David committed sin as king in Israel, and God punished him by killing 70,000 people from Israel, but none died from David's household. I'm sure we are convinced that we need to pray for our leaders so they do not commit sin, and you and I do not need to suffer for their sins. Brethren, I believe this is why God said in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, therefore, I exhort you, first of all, that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving thanks be made for all men, for kings, and all who are in authority. This is the Lord God commanding us that we should constantly pray for all our leaders so that you and I may lead a quiet and peaceful life. Therefore, it is in our own interest that we pray for all our leaders, political, religious, traditional, judiciary, social leaders, all our leaders. The consequences of their actions or inactions could bring famine or death on the land. Let us learn this fact and start to put it into practice. Every day we kneel down, let us commit our leaders into the hands of the living God. Now, let us go to the second question. What happened at the Brook Cherith? We know now that Elijah went to the Brook Cherith because there was famine in the land. So apart from backing Elijah's word up, God made special arrangements for him to be fed with bread and meat by the ravens morning and evening, and to drink from the brook Cherish. There was abundant provision for Elijah. I pray that the good Lord will make abundant provisions for you and I in Jesus' name. Some of the lessons here included that we must be totally obedient to God. Naturally, most of us will have shunned God's directive and gone to a bigger river, knowing that the brook will not be fed with rain and will soon dry up. But Elijah was obedient. He totally put his trust in God. This is the kind of Christians that we should be, even in these days of pandemic COVID-19. Elijah did not lack. I pray that God makes special provisions for us at this time of COVID-19. We shall not lack in Jesus' name. And we have God's assurance that we will not lack. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8, "And God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you, always having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work." This will be our portion in Jesus' name. We will have abundance for every good work. Another lesson to learn here is that we must shun fear. We must learn to trust God. Once we have heard God's word, or we have read it in the Bible, let us believe and not fear and not doubt. Even when we don't understand, because we cannot fully understand God, He gives us knowledge in parts. We know in parts. We understand in parts, says the Bible. He is God. We cannot fully understand Him. But our own role is to believe and trust Him totally. Elijah probably, like all of us, I don't know who has ever been fed by a bird. So it was a new thing. He never experienced it before. And yet, he believed it. He never heard or seen where birds fed a man before. And ravens, for that matter. Ravens are extremely stingy and selfish birds. They are the last birds that will give anybody meat. But God said, He has commanded. Because He's King of Kings, He's Lord of Lords, He's the creator of heaven and earth. To Him, nothing shall be impossible. This is a wonderful miracle. May the good Lord work out huge miracle in my life and in your life in Jesus' name. But he trusted and entertained no fear. He didn't query God as to, what will I do with the ravens? Will I kill it? Will I eat it? Will I cook it? These are the kind of things that will probably be going on in my mind and in your mind. But Elijah was not like that. He took the word of the Lord, has spoken to him, and he trusted totally. We should not allow worry, doubt, and fear to deprive us of our miracle. We should just do as our Lord says, like Elijah did, according to the word of the Lord. 1 Kings 17, verse 5. We also learn from this text that we should have faith in God. Having called down famine and drought on the land, Elijah watched the brook Cherith gradually dry up. Can you imagine? God said, "Go to Brook Cherith and you will drink from it." And then, maybe one day, 1 week or 2 weeks, and he saw that the brook was drying up. Brethren, if it were you and I, we would be so worried. Where do I go from now? Look at the brook, the Lord said, I should come and drink. It's even getting dried. And yet, God did not say anything about it. So, it is natural to begin to worry. But Elijah had faith in God. He didn't even give it a thought. We need to have faith and relax in the Lord. Even when all around us is telling us otherwise, that word that we have heard from the Lord, let us hold it tight. Because the Bible says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. Hebrews 11, verse 6. I believe that some of our prayers and miracles might have been granted by God, but we need faith to unlock them. Elijah had faith in God's ability. So must we. May the Lord help our unbelief and build up our faith in Jesus' name. We all could do with more faith. Another point here is that we should not lose hope. Because just when it seemed that everything was working well with Elijah, then the brook dried up. God waited until the brook dried up. God usually does not open another door until one has closed. So let us not be in a hurry. Let us just relax in the Lord. And when the brook dried up, the Lord sent him another word. He will send a word of joy, of blessing, of increase to you and I in Jesus' name. And the Lord told Elijah, arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. Awesome God, from ravens to a widow, there is nobody that the good Lord cannot use. And there is nothing that he cannot use. God of all flesh, to whom nothing is too difficult, is the Lord our God. Blessed be his name forever and ever in Jesus' name. I pray that God will send his word of hope, comfort, and provisions to you and I in Jesus' name. But we must trust and obey him like Elijah. Our faith must be unshakable. We must hold tight to his words. The Bible says in Psalm 84 verse 11, the Lord is our sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. I tell you, this verse continues to strengthen and encourage me. God will take care of all my needs, provided I walk uprightly. There's a condition. And no good thing will he withhold from us in Jesus' name. So the brook dried up. We have dealt with prior to the brook. Now, what happened at the brook? And now the brook dried up. So Elijah moved to Zarephath in Sidon for a better provision from God according to his word. So the final question, what happened after the brook dried up? We may have probably experienced situations close to where Elijah found himself, when hopes dried up, when plans failed, when despite fasting and praying, jobs were lost. We do not know where our next meal will come from. Brethren, I have no doubt that millions are going through this phase. And my advice is that we lift our eyes to the Lord. He will always show forth. He alone does wonderful, unsearchable things. It is written, I will seek unto God, and unto God will I commit my cause. Who does great things and unsearchable, marvelous things without number? Job 5, verses 8 and 9. We should also lift our eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh our help. Psalm 121, verse 1. The word sent to Elijah was, arise, go to Zarephath. Brethren, to receive our miracle, sometimes we need to arise. We need to move our eyes away from our challenges and go take steps of faith. It is of no use to sit in one place hoping that manna will fall from heaven. We have a role to play. We must make effort. We need to get up and go seek help, and God will make ways for us in Jesus' name. Because he knows our challenges. He sees what we are passing through and is perfectly able to solve all our problems. That will be our portion in Jesus' name. So we learned that God had lined up plans for us and for Elijah from the text. God always has plans for his children, like we mentioned earlier on. He knows the end from the beginning. Nothing catches him by surprise. He's always abreast with our situations, and he knows what to do. This is why we must trust him. This is why we worship him.
He knows all. He can do all. So we can be at peace once we commit our ways into his hand and we trust him and we keep away from sin and we obey his words. It shall be well with us in Jesus' name. Even the Bible says that we should cast our cares upon him, for he cares for us. 1 Peter 5:7. Sometimes we could get tested for a while because you and I will say, oh, but I've been praying about this for a long time and God is yet to answer. That is very true. That is also true in my life. But even there are some things that I didn't even pray about, that I just thought about, and God did it for me. So I continue to praise him until its own time when he will make all things beautiful. In John 6:6, we're told, this he said, referring to Christ, to test him, for he knew what he would do. So sometimes God tests us. That is not to say he does not have a plan. He knows what he will do, but sometimes he tests us. And let me encourage us with Jeremiah 29:11. God says, for I know the thoughts that I have towards you. Thoughts of good and not of evil, so that we will come to expected end. May this be our portion in Jesus' name. So we know that when we put our trust in God, he will surround us with help. He will surround us with good supply. He will support us. He will cast away shame from you and I in the mighty name of Jesus. Now, another thing we should learn here is that we must be at alert to hear from God. God communicates to us in various ways. He could send his word like he did for Elijah. He may also speak through another person to us. He may communicate to us in 101 ways or even more than 100. But whatever way that the Lord chooses to communicate with us, we have to be at alert to hear him. He's not a God that forces himself on us. You just hear this quiet word in your mind. And when you heed it, you get your miracle. May God help us in Jesus' name. We must be generous. Elijah met the widow at the entrance of the city. She was gathering sticks to prepare a last meal for herself and her son. Elijah asked her for water. Honestly, some of these things, we wonder whether we could pass this test. It was a time of famine, something akin to the time of lockdown during this pandemic COVID-19, when you are counting the tubers of yam and they are just going down. And someone says, please give me. May the Lord give us grace. We need the grace of God to pass this test. It's not of our own. We need his help. Because this Elijah, this widow, let's remember that God said he had commanded. So God had put that ability in her. Because most men will not pass this test. And Elijah said, give me water. And she was willing to give him water. I'm sure she didn't have a lot of water herself. The widow and her son were even expecting death, eat this last meal and die. Elijah asked for water. Then he also asked for a morsel of bread. This is too much. The widow herself was in adversity because of the famine, not even knowing that the famine was caused by this same Elijah. Yet she was willing to share the little she had with the man of God. We need to emulate this. We need to emulate this. A trick to going about is that when your first reaction is, sorry, I can't spare, then tell yourself, I can spare in Jesus' name and give something little out. It will bring blessings in Jesus' name. Another thing we can learn here is about widowhood. We learn here that it could happen to anybody. Widows are not God's offenders. The fact that someone is a widow does not mean the person is less godly. From this story, the widow was generous, was God-fearing. And let us know the fact that God could only entrust his servants to the care of a widow. There would have been many people who were not widows in that time, yet it was only a widow that God trusted. So let me say that God loves widows specially, and widows should love God in return and shun bitterness. This particular widow was not blaming God, probably for the death of her husband or for the situation she found herself. She had not turned against God, and God took adequate care of her. There is hope for every godly widow. Don't worry if you are a widow, but if you are in the Lord, He will take care of you, because He even said that He is husband to the widow and father to the fatherless. Back to our story. When Elijah went further to ask for a morsel of bread, the widow had to speak up. I'm managing to give you water. Now you are asking for bread. The widow said she had no bread. One. And two, she had only a handful of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar to eat with her son and die. We will not die in the mighty name of Jesus. We will live. Elijah told her not to fear, but that she was to make food for him first and then make for herself and her son. 1 Kings 17:13. As close as this widow was to her miracle, she could easily have failed at this point. It's bad enough that you are begging for these things. You now order her to prepare your own first. But as she made to go in obedience to the man of God, God sent a word to her. So may the good Lord give us the grace to obey Him, to fear Him enough, to take steps that are irrational, so to say. Elijah said, "For thus says the Lord, God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the day that the Lord sends rain on earth." 1 Kings 17:14. I believe this is the word of God for you and I today. We shall dwell in abundance during and beyond pandemic COVID-19 in the mighty name of Jesus. We also learn here the unusual kindness shown by the widow. A good way to move the hand of God for blessings and miracles is to be unusually kind in spite of adversity. Just when you are suffering and you are in need, no matter what, there are millions that are in a worse situation than us. We should extend kindness to them. We should be willing to give to the needy and the less privileged, even if all we have is inadequate. Let us learn from David, who gave a dying slave food and drink, and through the slave, David got the direction to his enemies, and he was able to recover all he had lost because he showed kindness to a slave. 1 Samuel 30:11. Kindness will always bring us blessings. If this is all we take away from this message today, it's more than important. Let us learn to show kindness at all times, when it's comfortable for us and when it's not comfortable. Let us continue to be kind. Another lesson here is pleasing God first. Like I said earlier, the widow said she had only her last meal, yet Elijah asked for her to make his own first. Then she would have abundance. Truth is, if we want to walk with God, He has to come first. We don't serve God when it's convenient. We serve God at all times, both when it's convenient and when it's not convenient. We cannot please ourselves before pleasing God. It has to be God first. And when we do that, we have abundance, because all other things shall be added to us. Matthew 6:33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto us. As long as we seek God first, I can confidently say we will not lack anything good in Jesus' name. Another lesson is that when God requires something from us, it is because He wants to bless us. Let us remember that he's King of Kings, he's Lord of Lords. There's nothing he cannot do. Everything belongs to him. So what does he need? It is only when he wants to bless you and I that he asks us to give something. May we not fail at that time, at that moment, in Jesus' name. Particularly when he asked for something precious, when he asked for something that is inadequate even for us. When he asked, it's because he wants to transform the little in our hand to super abundance. We could learn this from the story of feeding of 5,000 men with a leftover of 12 baskets from 5 loaves and 2 fishes. The Bible said God knew what he wanted to do. Let us willingly offer the little we have, like the widow of Zarephath offered to Elijah, and we'll be surprised with abundance that will replace it in Jesus' name. Proverbs 3, 9 and 10 also encourage us to honor the Lord with our substance and with the first fruits of all our increase. So shall our barns be filled with plenty, and our presses shall burst out with new wine. Giving to the Lord is an investment, and he will repay and reward us richly in Jesus' name. We must trust that if door closes, a bigger one will open. We must be hopeful. When the brook dried up, it opened an opportunity for a better, more comfortable, and more permanent solution to Elijah. The word of the Lord says, the flour will not be used up. So this time, he had confidence that it wouldn't be like Brook Cherish that dried up. The flour will not be used up, nor the oil dry up until the day God sends down the rain. It was an open check, so to say. We could learn this even in the story of Ruth. In Ruth chapter 1, 16 to 18, having lost her husband, she chose to show love and concern for her mother-in-law. Though she too was hurting, but she cared for her mother-in-law who had lost all her children, all her sons, and had lost her husband. So she placed his need above her own. And what happened? Ruth, through this act, got married to the wealthy Boaz and gave birth to Obed, the father of Jesse. So Ruth, a Moabite, not even an Israelite, could be traced in the genealogy of Jesus and David. She made history forever. When we do unusual good things, we write our names with gold. God opened a greater door for Ruth. He will open better and greater doors of blessing to us in Jesus' name. When we are faithful in a little, God gives us much more. We also learn this from this story. God often starts us off on a small blessing. He will try and see what our reaction to that blessing is, whether we are stingy with it or whether we are generous with it, before releasing a greater blessing to us. God does test us. He wants to be sure that we can handle the blessing. So many people have been ruined because they became wealthy overnight. It kind of goes into an average man's head. So God does it a little at a time. When the brook dried up, as expected, since there was no rain, Elijah did not grumble or complain. He just trusted that his God will make a way for him. And God gave him a more abundant provisions that will not dry up in Zarephath. Our Lord Jesus said in Luke 19, 17, well done, good servant. Because you were faithful in a very little, have authority over 10 cities. May this be our portion in Jesus' name. In other words, no matter the place we have found ourselves in life, let us be grateful. Let us appreciate God. Let us be conscious that there are millions that are in a worse condition that are praying to even be in our shoes. So let us not grumble. Let us not complain. Let us keep trusting and thanking God. And it will open even greater doors of joy to us in Jesus' name. In conclusion, the focus of this message is that we need to trust God for all our needs. And that if we are obedient and walk uprightly, the good Lord will provide our every need and surround us with abundance in Jesus' name. This is only true if we are His children and have been born by His Spirit into His family. We cannot claim. I often hear people, no weapon fashioned. You just don't throw God's words up and down. It will bounce away. We need to have what it takes. And what it takes is that we must be His children. We need to do, what we need to do is to accept that Jesus came to die for us sinners. Then repent of our sins. Accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Then we can truly dwell in His love and He will provide all our needs. The Bible says, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. 1 John 1:8. And He also says, but if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. Let us decide for Jesus today. Let us make Him our Lord and Savior. We thank the Lord for His word. May His word germinate and bring much fruit in us in Jesus' name. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for sowing Your word into our hearts. We pray that it meets with faith in us and that it brings much fruit in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise ye the Lord. The Lord is good.